This is Hiroja Shibe with another episode of Hiroja Thought Bubble. This is episode 7, in which I'm reviewing the documentary about Aaron Swartz, the activist, and hacktivist, if you will, who was responsible for getting SOPA and shutting down the internet and bringing awareness of that movement about the policy changes that the U.S. government is doing towards the internet that would have restricted individuals' freedoms. He's a long-time activist when it comes towards the internet. He unfortunately committed an act of suicide due to an overreach on the part of the government when it was a result of him distributing information from a database freely to the people. We'll get into that in a little bit, but that's just a thumbnail sketch about Aaron Swartz. But the name of the movie is Internet's Own Boy, and one of the reasons why I'm reviewing it is because it's one of my favorite documentaries on the subject of the internet and people that are help contribute to the growth and the changes and the things that we utilize on the internet. But because July 12th is going to be another shutdown of the internet where a lot of different companies are going to go black, they're going to not have their services for 24 hours. As a result of a protest towards net neutrality, which is still in its comment period, and you can still, contact your congressperson, your U.S. senator, or if you're a foreign national, write on behalf of your government to talk to the U.S. government in regards to this change in policy of net neutrality. So let's discuss Internet's Own Boy. So the movie itself has a 93% fresh rating. It came out in 2014. It also has a 91% rating for the audience. The movie itself is a story of the program prodigy and information activist Aaron Swartz. From Swartz's help in the development of the basic internet protocol RSS to his co-founding Reddit, his fingerprints are all over the internet. But it was Swartz's groundbreaking work in social justice and political organizations combined with his aggressive approach to information access that ensured him in a 2-year legal nightmare. It was that battle that ended with him taking his own life at the age of 26. Aaron Swartz touched a nerve with people far beyond the online communities in which he was a celebrity. The film is a personal story about what we lose when we are tone deaf about technology and the relationship to our civil liberties. It was directed by Brian Knebber and written by Brian Knebber and Lincoln Else. It was released in theaters in 2014, came out on disc in 2015. Let's see. Brian Knebber, if you are familiar with that name, is responsible for the documentary on We Are Legion, the story of the hacktivists, as well as Bloomberg's Game Changers, which is a TV series documentary that did like 19 episodes about different people within different parts of the industry. You might have seen it like at MSNBC or at cable out there. They did everything from like Mark Cuban to Reid Hoffman to J.K. Rowling. It was about, one of those kind of A&E style, kind of short, 1-hour episodic documentaries about a subject matter. But I think he's mostly known for this movie as well as the hacktivist movie. He also has another movie coming out called Nobody Speak, The Trials of Free Press. So he's a documentarian. So before I get into my review, a little bit about Aaron Swartz himself. If you're very unfamiliar with him, this is from his Wicca. As an American computer programmer, entrepreneur, writer, political organizer, and internet hacktivist. He's involved in the development of the WebFi format, RSS. So if you use, any, blogs or any internet, web pages or podcasting, you have like an RSS feed. He's responsible for that development, those easy clickable links where you can catch news articles. You can embed it into your email services now, so you can get like all the news articles, just like you back in the day. I used to get out, the newspaper on your front door. You can get it into your email service. Podcast catchers use RSS feeds, allows for the distributing of information in a very easy, very readable manner. I think it's not as widely utilized as it should be, and it's free to utilize. So nobody owns it. It's under the. He's also responsible for help creating the Creative Commons, which is. An open source type of platform that says these are the parameters upon which you can utilize my work, whether it's by either giving an attribution, not using it for commercialized purposes. You can share alike. You don't really care how it's utilized as long as you maybe attribute or just simply share. Things of that nature. He's responsible for that development. So RSV, it's something that's utilized throughout the internet that allow for ease of usage and convenience for a lot of people when it came to obtaining information. Creative Commons, it helped allow for the development of a lot of not only open source projects, but media, art, allowing for people to have greater control of their art without having to go through the trademark office or even get things patented or copyrighted. And then, of course, Reddit, one of the biggest websites out there. They get ranks number 4th in America, maybe somewhere in the top 150 worldwide. He was there as part of the responsibility for the early development of that. He's also had done, here we go. So he focused on civic awareness and activism. He helped launch Progressive Change Campaign Committee to learn about effective online activism. He became a research fellow at the Harvard University, directed by Lawrence Lessig, one of the early pioneers of infrastructure protocols for the internet. He's a big, big time developer when it comes to the early acts of the internet. Demand Progress, known for campaigning against the Stop Online Privacy Act, or SOPA. He's one responsible for campaigning and bringing that down. On January 6, 2011, Schwartz was arrested by the MIT police as a state-breaking entering charges after connecting the computer to the MIT network in an unmarked unlocked closet and setting it to download academic journal articles systematically from Gestor, which is the, if you've ever been to university or colleges or ever been to a library, these are these academic journal thesis papers, medical papers, law papers, things of that nature. They're basically put behind a paywall and you have to either be a student, a researcher to gain access to it, or you have to pay an absorbent amount of money if you don't have that kind of access. And it kind of limits the type of knowledge that's being distributed. And a lot of people are trying to fight this or trying to get this to be where you can, I think it's called Sci-Fi Hub, where a lot of scientific papers, which are hosted in Russia, are being distributed. Because of Schwartz and his efforts on the legal end of getting legal documentation, where you had to literally pay like 10 cents a page in order to either print or access or see legal cases, that has changed to where it's not like that, where now it's more easily obtainable. There's a higher threshold to be able to obtain records, legal documentation and records. It's not completely free, but it's progressing towards that. What else? A lot of journalists are journalistic. People that write these papers or are seeking to freely distribute it so that way there's access. Because of his effort and because of some of the changes that he helped brought, and a lot of it had to do with, unfortunately, his death, significant scientific discoveries have been made because this information was opened up. The files that he downloaded and other activists have downloaded in his name have led to significant medical discoveries. But a lot of it, the reason why he was facing such harsh time is because of this very antiquated and old law called the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, where he was facing up to 20 years to life in prison for downloading documents. Federal prosecutors later charged him with 2 counts of wire fraud and 11 violations of the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, carrying a cumulative penalty of $1 million in fines and 35 years in prison, asset forfeitures, restitution, and supervised release. He committed suicide while under federal indictment for his alleged computer crimes. Schwartz declined plea bargain, under which he would have served 6 months in federal prison. 2 days after the prosecution rejected a counteroffer by Schwartz, he was found dead in the Brooklyn apartment where he had hanged himself. In June 2013, Schwartz was inducted posthumously into the Internet Hall of Fame. So this is about his life story. He also lives a celebration. He's also responsible for SecureJob, which is a whistleblower platform that allows for people that have sensitive information they want to disclose, whether it be for corporations, governments, things of that nature, that type of information, to contact journalists in a secure manner using Tails or Tor, gaining access, going to the websites of these specified news platforms that have SecureJob built in. There's a whole type of system with it, with servers and connections to make sure it's secure and encrypted, so that way the individual giving the information to the journalist is, remains anonymous and they're not being tracked down in any type of fashion. He helped develop that platform. They just celebrated 4 years. And so things of that nature are the things that Aaron Schwartz has done. You know, the online activism that he did to gather and stop SOPA and the one after it from gaining traction in the United States, organizing shutdowns of, you know, the blackout of the internet. He's responsible for making blacking out the internet a thing, where people black out their social media platforms, where they black out their entire business infrastructure, their websites, things of that nature, to demonstrate the power of the internet and garner not only public support, but demonstrate to governments and corporations and companies the actual full weight and power that the internet has in our daily lives, and that why it's necessary, and he fundamentally believes, and he states in the documentary that he believes that everyone has a right to connect, everyone has a right to communicate, and nothing should impede that. So that is the man, that is the person who is the subject of this documentary. It goes from very much from his very beginning as a childhood prodigy, going through his childhood, all the way through, I guess he's like 13 years old when he went to Stanford University. I believe he eventually completed his degree, but then he dropped out for a little bit, you know, working on RSCs, talking and communicating with, you know, complete adults, and developing all these different types of systems and platforms, and eventually, you know, helping contribute to Reddit. He had his own kind of a Wicca style freedom type of thing that he also developed. And he's always been a hacktivist. He's always been seeking to make the internet better, seeking it to be more freely and more open for everyone to utilize. He's responsible for the Guerrilla Manifesto. We read that manifesto on, the first episode of A Word for the Metaverse. So this is the type of person you just go through. And it's a very well done documentary. I liked it. They had members of his family. They had people that knew him, people in his life. They go kind of almost chronological order, all the way up to the point to where he was arrested and facing jail time. His activism. They have his own words. He was filmed quite a lot. Not as much as other people were. He committed suicide in 2013. So he kind of grew up in the age of, you know, he was born in the, you know, late 80s, going mid 80s, going through, he was 26 when he passed away. So going through his life, he's not quite as much filmography on of him as, say, for someone who would be a subject now, if you were to do a documentary now. I think more and more people, because of YouTube and iPhones, even though video cameras have been around for a while, everyone had a video camera and filmed everything. But when you hear him speak, he has a very commanding presence. He's very articulate. He actually, when he does speak, and he's speaking on very complex subject matters, he speaks in a very easily understood for a lay person. And he's not condescending or talks down to people. He wants people to know. He wants people to have an understanding of the importance of communication, importance of freedom, and how this tool that we have is the greatest tool ever given, and how it needs to be protected, but also shared globally. Like I said, it's a very well done documentary, very focused, very factual. There's not too much speculation, and I would say, even though Aaron Schwartz is the subject of the documentary, you don't feel like it. You know, it goes into both his some negative aspects of him, some things that people don't necessarily want to bring up or anything like that. But well, it champions Aaron Schwartz. It's a fully realized documentary. It's very factual. It's very objective, in my personal opinion. And those are the type of documentaries I like, where they do follow a subject around, and you're kind of getting, you know, their perspective and viewpoint, but you're keeping a bit of a distance to where you're able to see and view and judge, and not to be so enamored with the person that you kind of gloss over some of the both bad or negative attributes, and you don't see, you know, the forest and the trees when it comes to the subject matter. So that's what I really appreciate about this particular documentary. You know, it's on digital streaming services. It's not on Netflix, but I believe it's on Hulu. You can catch it for free on YouTube. You can also purchase it, on DVD or from your digital service, Google Play, whichever services you utilize out there. Not that long of a documentary. I think it almost touches 2 hours. And like it just literally comes from David, was it David Copperfield, from basically birth to the end of his life. It's very sad. When it does get towards the end of his life and when he gets into his activism, they do a little bit of speculation. A lot of the people that are in supporters are stating that they believe the government may be responsible for his death. Some even go into conspiracy thinking that the government actually killed him. Most of it, like his families and friends, are like, they never saw the signs of suicidal thoughts or, him being depressive or anything like that. They are very suspicious of his death, but they can't, prove it one way or another, and they acknowledge that it's something he may have done himself. And it's very hard when it comes to the subject of suicide for people to see. They don't want to believe their loved one would do such an act, but for all intents and purposes, that is the case that Aaron Schwartz is something that he did. There's not any evidence to the contrary, but I just want to bring it up because it is touched on the documentary that there is that bit of conspiracy about him. I think it's a very important documentary because it shows the mindset of some of the very early developers. And when I'm talking early developers, I'm not talking about the 60s or 70s or even 80s early developers, or even the cypherpunk guys themselves. Aaron Schwartz was on that mailing list, but he was a very young person at the time. I'm talking about the people that are the current modern internet that we have, the people like from Napster, which is the next documentary I'm going to do, Download by Alex Winter. The people that helped develop the internet that we see today, those type of individuals like Aaron Schwartz, he's one of the pioneers, he's one of the lead developers of the modern internet that we currently see as we interact and engage. His efforts, his activism to protect it, his inspiration to other people, is still resonating and having influence. This is why you have things like the July 12th shutdown. He's proven as very effective by utilizing the internet in this manner, because of things like the WikiLeaks and Snowden and even Anonymous, which we'll eventually cover both on A Word for the Metaverse and here on the documentary about a couple different documentaries about Anonymous. These type of pushes, these type of individuals like Aaron Schwartz, these groups that have made people more aware about the ability to communicate, to engage, maybe even secure their information, whether they're encrypting it, to seek to make sure that things are easily distributed. Like, why are journalists, not journalists, but journals, academic journals, that basically, particularly in the States, are paid by grants by the United States government, are held by a private corporation that is then charging back to universities and other universities globally a fee to see this information? This information should be freely, widely distributed. It is the best intent, the best means upon which not only to learn and know things, but by distributing this information to a wide enough eyeballs, if you will, then solutions are found. Because of Aaron Schwartz's activities and his inspiration of others going and downloading this information on very designated days, using their accounts to freely distribute both journals as well as legal documentation, his effect on the distributing of the law, if you will, freely for people to see. They get into that in the documentary. Because of his actions, solutions have been found. There was a cure that was found by a young boy that was able to look at the documentation for an illness that he was very much interested in, and he found a solution. He found a method, and because of that, because of these type of activities that Aaron Schwartz does, and it just covers the breadth and bandwidth of it. And it's just very sad. He was a very young person. He was 26 years old. There was a lot that he could have done with his life if he continued to live. And just the fact that the U.S. government is so harsh with this act that has not yet at this point in time been repealed. For downloading information and distributing it, you're giving him more time than, murderers and crime lords and people that have actually done serious irreparable harm to other people or to the environment. environment or even serious irreparable harm to the economy or the financial system, he's getting more time for zeros and ones, really. Overall, like I said, I really enjoyed the documentary. I think it's important if you want to understand why people are for distributing information. It's not about stealing or thievery. It's about, you know, expanding the human mind, expanding the human existence, about the concept of a right of communication, and how internet activism, as you see today, that everyone's talks about, from Black Lives Matter to the Umbrella Movement, to the Arab Spring, all these different groups are out there, how they engage and interact, and it's because of efforts like Aaron Schwartz helping them, seeking and communicating and developing those types of systems so that they can communicate, that such movements do exist. So I recommend it. I give it, you know, 5 out of 5 stars. There is one other documentary that's out there about Aaron Schwartz. It's called Kill Switch. I don't think it's as good. If you're looking for an Aaron Schwartz documentary, you might come up and you might see it. It's about controlled internet. On him as a subject, I don't think he is as good. It just kind of covers overall about the, you know, the purpose of his, the controlled internet, and he's on there. It kind of goes into the things he's done, but glosses over him as a person. But this right here, if you want to know more about Aaron Schwartz, if you've heard of his name, then this is a good documentary that covers him and does it a strong job. It's very well done. So that's it for this episode. I encourage you to listen to the companion episode to this, which is about Aaron Schwartz as a person. We'll talk about his activities with SOPA, his development of RS Feed, as well as Secure Drop, and his relationship to the movement now that's seeking to address net neutrality with the blackout date and the different companies that are supporting blacking out the internet on July 12th of 2017. So thank you for listening, and until next time.
Thank you for listening. Please rate and review either through iTunes or Stitchers or any of the podcasting apps that you're currently using to listen to this show. Thank you, and until next time.
This has been a Horosha Show Space Odyssey Network production.